Welcome to a Big Picture Channel podcast on Total Picture Radio. This is a podcast and vodcast. Yes, we are shooting video again. This is Peter Clayton, and joining me today through the magic of Skype video is Russell Glass, head of products for LinkedIn Marketing Solutions. I first met Russ when he was founder, president, and CEO of a company called Bizzo, a little B2B audience marketing and data platform that was acquired by LinkedIn in 2014 for about $175 million. Russell is co-author of a new book titled The Big Data-Driven Business, published by Wiley. Russ, great to see you, and thanks for taking time to speak with me today.
Yeah, always a pleasure. Thank you.
So, by the way, his co-author, Sean Callahan, was the marketing director at Bizzo and is now the senior manager of content management at LinkedIn. And, you know, what I like about this book is Russ and Sean are not talking theory. They're not blowing smoke. They've accomplished and practiced much of what they're writing about here, namely how to use big data to win customers, beat competitors, and boost profits. And Rush and Sean can check off all of those boxes. So before we dive into your book, Russ, can you give us a little bit of your background, a little backstory for us?
Yeah, sure. So I've always been entrepreneurial. You know, started my career at a very entrepreneurial software company called Trilogy Software right after I graduated from Duke, and founded companies and was part of management teams all the way up to just pre-Bizzo, where I was running B2B marketing and products for a company called ZoomInfo, and just saw that all the products that were really being thoughtful about marketing were consumer focused, right? They were focused on how do you market to consumers more effectively. But nobody was really thinking about B2B. And so Bizzo came out of this, me being a B2B marketer and wanting to be more focused and wanting to be more successful as a B2B marketer. And so built Bizzo to solve those problems and you know, now doing a lot of the same things while integrating it into LinkedIn.
How has this transition been for you, Russ? You know, going from basically running your own show to now being part of a very large organization?
Yeah, I mean, big change, right?
Yeah, sure.
By far the largest company that I've ever worked for. And you know, it's interesting. My wife likes to say that this is really good for me, kind of moving from unilateral decisions to having to work through a bunch of people to get things done.
Yeah.
And she's probably right. One of the things we saw going into this was that the culture of LinkedIn was such a great fit with the culture of Bizzo. Very entrepreneurial, thoughtful people. They're excited to come to work every day. They're excited to solve big problems. They believe in the vision of the company to do really big things for the world's professional workforce. And that's just a very exciting thing to be a part of. And so I would say all in all, the transition has gone very well.
That's great because it's so important, the culture piece of this thing. If that doesn't work, you're out the door in a couple of months.
Yeah, that's right? Exactly right. I like to say the host rejects the foreign body, right? If you don't have the culture right. And, you know, thankfully we saw it going in, but you never know till you get there. And we've been extremely impressed.
We're recording this interview on Friday, January 30th. And in today's Wall Street Journal, there's a front page story titled "Metadata Can Expose Person's Identity Even Without Name." And I'll put a link to this article on Russ's show page in the Big Picture channel of Total Picture Radio. And quoting from the article, researchers at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, writing Thursday in the Journal of Science, analyzed anonymous credit card transactions by 1.1 million people. And using a new analytic formula, they needed only 4 bits of unique individual information, metadata such as location or timing, to identify the unique individual purchasing patterns of 90% of the people involved, even when the data was scrubbed of names, account numbers, and other obvious identifiers. So the core to this whole discussion about big data and the amazing insights it can provide marketers and recruiters is the whole discussion about privacy. So how can companies like LinkedIn use big data responsibly and respect the privacy of your members?
Yeah,
it's long great. Question.
Great question and very timely and pertinent, right? I think, first of all, in the book, The Big Data-Driven Business, we dedicate an entire chapter to this.
Right.
Out of, 14 chapters. And part of the reason for that is how important this is and how core this is. And the simple answer to this is that companies who trade in big data, companies who are going to use big data to make their marketing efforts more successful, to make their customer experiences more successful, have to design their products and services with privacy in mind. And if you do that, right, if you're thoughtful about how you build these products, we call it privacy by design, then you create transparency for your users, you create control for your users, and you don't allow things like some of the breaches we've seen out there to happen, because if you've thought of that upfront, you're solving for those problems for your customers. At the end of the day, it's just being responsible, right? It's not any magic. It's just being thoughtful about and purposeful about how you design these capabilities.
Well, speaking to that whole thing, last month I recorded an interview with my good friend Jerry Crispin titled "Sony is like a bellwether for 2015," and we were discussing the ramifications in the C-suite specifically regarding the Sony hack. And we're not talking about movies here. This is all about lawsuits and a lot of Sony's employees and past employees having their personal medical history released out into the internet. So, I mean, this is something companies really have to get a handle on.
No doubt about it. I mean, Sony's a great example of a company that was asleep at the wheel, right? I mean, at the end of the day, at the end of the day, a lot of this stuff can be avoided if you're paying attention to it. Now, I think Sony is a wake-up call to a lot of boardrooms around the country.
Oh, absolutely.
Right? Who are saying to themselves, man, I'm glad this wasn't us, because it could have been us.
Mm-hmm.
Let's get our act together. And so, at the, expensive for Sony, expensive for their shareholders and for their employees, but it's actually pretty cheap for everybody else to, as a wake-up call, to get their act together.
Let's face it, Russ, most companies aren't out there making silly movies about North Korea, but you never know what's going to trigger one of these hacking groups.
Oh, there's no doubt about it. And look, if you put your mind to it as a hacker, you can hack anything, right? We've seen that proven, right? The NSA has been hacked. The CIA has been hacked, right? So the fact that, you're putting something online means that it is hackable. So the question then is, what are the mitigation strategies? How do you make sure that you've got the right components in place to manage something like that when it happens? And in the case of Sony, they clearly just hadn't ever considered that this was a possibility.
Which comes to a question that I have for you. So how do B2B companies leverage big data differently from what B2C companies traditionally do?
Yeah, I think the biggest difference with B2B companies is how niche and important the relevance of information is to their audiences, right? So in the consumer world, you have these large cohorts, right? These cohorts of 16 to 24-year-olds, or these cohorts of people who are raising small children, right? Very big, sizable cohorts. In the B2B space, you're dealing with very niche groups of people, right? So HR professionals in the finance industry, CFOs in the technology industry. And depending on who you're talking to, the message has to be very different, right? That's first of all. So you need messages that are very aligned to the audience you're talking to drive success and to drive efficiency in your marketing. Two is, the value of each customer is so much higher in the B2B world that being thoughtful about what companies you're going after and taking the time to put the right content in front of the right people, taking the time to make sure that you're creating a great experience for them is hugely important, right? Because each deal in a B2B world could be worth lifetime value, literally millions of dollars. And so you're able to spend more time focused on driving the right leads and putting the right leads in front of the right people.
That is absolutely a terrific point that you make there, as each one of these leads can really be worth millions of dollars, where, you know, in the consumer world, it's usually, you know, a one-time or a transactional thing, where you're with the B2B, you're trying to build a relationship.
That's exactly right. And the other thing about B2B is decisions are made differently. I use an example to help illustrate this. So, you know, if you're thirsty as a consumer and you go into a store and you see Coke and you see DMG Cola, you go right for the Coke, right? Mm-hmm. But if you've seen an ad earlier that day that said DMG Cola tastes like Coke but entirely organic, now you walk in the store and you're actually prepared to make a different decision, right? You're prepared to say, oh, DMG Cola, I saw an ad, tastes like Coke, entirely organic, I'll give it a try. The B2B example is, let's say that your boss came to you and said, hey, you know, Peter, I want you to throw a party and you're responsible for the soda, right?
Right.
Now you go to the store, you saw that ad, DMG Cola, tastes like Coke, but entirely organic. What do you choose?
You're going to go safe. You're going to go for the Coke.
That's exactly right. You're going to go for the Coke. And that's how B2B decisions are made every day, because the risk is way higher. You don't want to mess that party up, right?
Right, right. I mean, the old song is, you know, no one ever got fired for hiring a McKinsey consultant, right?
Exactly. That's exactly right.
And or IBM or any of the, exactly. Yeah.
Exactly. So the net of it, though, is that is something that, as a B2B marketer, how do you change the decision, right? Well, you've got to create case studies. You know, people like you that you trust that have thrown parties using DMG Cola and have been, they've been wildly successful, right? You've got to create white papers that show why using an organic soda is more effective than, I mean, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right?
Right.
B2B is a very different world and decisions are made differently, which means big data can be highly effective in showing you what messages to put in front of what constituents at the right time.
You know, I think this brings up a really important point that you make in your book. And, you know, I think a common misperception is that big data is used most effectively by big companies. And you cite numerous examples in your book where small companies have made extensive and very profitable use of big data. Can you give us a couple of examples of how this has worked?
Yeah, sure. I mean, what's happened is over the last, you know, 20 years or so, the cost of storage has gone down so precipitously. The cost of processing power has gone up so or down relative to the processing power that anybody can afford this now, right?
Right.
The capabilities are there for anybody. And so we see amazing examples of companies, you know, a great example of something that happened a few years ago is the Obama campaign that, you know, was out there raising money. They were behind the Clinton campaign and they needed to raise enough money to be able to place ads in the key markets. And they had this big video campaign that they wanted to put out there. And all the pundits, right, everybody who had been in politics forever said, this video A, we'll call it, is the one that should win. Well, Dan Soroker, the guy that was heading up their digital marketing, said, you know, look, let's just test it. Let's do an A-B test, and we'll see which one wins, and we'll use that one. Well, it turned out, right, that video F, the one that all the pundits hated, drove significantly higher contribution rates than video A, leading to $61 million more dollars raised than video A would have. And you could argue won the election for Obama because that allowed them to buy these key market campaigns that they needed to buy. So, like, you know, that is a simple example of something every single marketer on the planet should be doing. If they're not A-B testing everything they do today, I truly believe they're literally not doing their jobs, right? I mean, that is just table stakes at this point because it's cheap, it's easy, and it can drive massive lift in your marketing efforts.
Oh, that's some really great advice. You know, I'm wondering, Russ, is there sort of a Moore's Law type of growth happening in data mining software and in the ability to, you know, accurately project future trends, you know, every 18 months or so, doubling the speed and the capacity and the accuracy of what you're able to do with big data?
Yeah, well, it's a great point. This is all following Moore's Law at the end of the day, right? So Moore originally predicted that every 2 years we would see a doubling of the processing power for the same cost.
Right. Now this is Gordon Moore, who was the founder of Intel.
That's exactly right.
Right.
Gordon Moore. And it turns out, you know, he was largely right. It's been every 18 months or so, not 2 years, but it turns out he was right. And, you know, today, the processing power that's, you know, sitting in your iPhone, right, is like six times the processing power that sent, you know, the astronauts to the moon. That's just astonishing, right? We're producing more data today than the stat is that the Library of Congress is being produced every 4 hours, right?
Right. I mean, right.
The astonishing, and it is continuing to accelerate. The next stage of this will be Internet of Things, right? So as all the data that's produced by those, you'll see at least a doubling in the next 18 months of the data that's coming off of the different internet devices that are coming out. And so this is only going to get more complex. The good news for marketers, though, is that the same principles apply whether you've got terabytes of data or petabytes of data, right? You need to find signal in that noise. You need to A/B test. You need to think about personas that you want to go after and how to put the right valuable message in front of them to make your content more valuable to them.
You write really convincingly in your book about the importance of CMOs working closely with and perhaps even leading the IT departments in their organizations. And I think it's equally important for CHROs to work closely with CMOs and CIOs in organizations, considering, you know, all the explosion of social media and what's happening with mobile and how, you know, the HR departments and recruiters need to interact now with what's going on with marketing.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. I mean, I think everybody in the executive function at a company today needs to be thinking, how can we better use the data and the exhaust that we have in our departments? How do we bring that all together in a way that can help grow the business and help make our customer experiences better? Another example I like to use is, you know, I called the airline the other day, and instead of the press one for this, press two for that, press three for this, it just said, "Hello, Mr. Glass, we recognized your phone number. Are you calling about tomorrow's flight?" Right, that is a game-changing experience.
Oh, no kidding. I mean, the phone tree thing is just ridiculous.
Ridiculous, right? So the fact that they, in order to do that, what did they have to do? They had to take a database of cell phone numbers, associate it with my contact information, so they know my name. They had to take the flight database and bring that in and integrate that in a way that creates a great experience for me. The same goes for everything you're doing in marketing, everything you're doing as an HR organization. How do you create great experiences for your customers and for your employees and for all your shareholders and constituents in a way that just makes life better for them, right? Makes their experience better.
Well, let's talk a little bit more about what I'm going to call predictive analytics, because that's basically what happened to you on that phone call with your airlines, as they predicted because of the data that they had in place that you were calling about your flight. And, you know, in recruiting and HR, the leaders think of predictive analytics as both an opportunity and a real threat. I mean, there's a number of companies, as you know, like Jobrate, who are able to mine your organization's data and tell you, for instance, who are the top performers in your organization, who is possibly going to leave within the next 6 months, who are the deadwood in your organization. So have we reached a stage where a machine can tell us what we're planning to do before we even know it ourselves?
Yeah, I mean, The answer is yes, right? We've gotten to the point where the data processing, the amount of data that can be processed, can be very predictive. And you see that, again, creating great experiences. I don't know if you've ever used the Waze app, the traffic app that uses mm-hmm. crowdsourced data. You know, you leave your office and it says, are you going home? Yeah, I'm going home, right? Mm-hmm. Great experience, right? I just hit yes and away we go. How does it know that? Well, it's seen me over the last few days at a certain range of times leave a certain location and go to another location. It's predicting success. In the business world, these predictive analytics can really help you be more successful targeting the right kinds of customers. So, you know, simple example, mine all of your highest value customers and start to see, oh, it turns out my highest value customers often are in the process of or have just changed office spaces. Or it turns out that, you know, my most high value customers are hiring in the ops department. These are insights you'd never have any idea are correlated with your product or service. But by using a lot of data crunching, you can pull this out and really drive not only better business results, but again, a better experience for those customers because you're predicting what they might be interested in.
You know, I've often said to people who in large companies who are running HR departments that LinkedIn knows more about your employees than you do. Do you think that's true?
In a lot of cases, I do think that's true. It's certainly true that we have a better understanding of a person's network than an internal company does, and who they know and who they could bring to bear against certain situations. And it's one of the reasons LinkedIn is working on capabilities that will help employers understand their employee base better.
One thing that I think has really blindsided a lot of people in the HR and recruiting world is the phenomenal adoption of mobile and how so many people are now using their mobile device as their primary communication tool. So how is this impacting what's going on at LinkedIn? I'm sure that a tremendous amount of the traffic that you're experiencing on your network today is off of mobile devices.
So again, very, very astute point. LinkedIn actually is in the middle of its mobile moment where we're flipping from most of our traffic being on desktop to most of our traffic being on mobile. And, you know, we'll never look back, right? So already we're seeing more of our traffic on mobile devices. That's where the growth's going to come from, particularly internationally, but even in the United States. And I think every company out there should be thoughtful about, hey, your users are going to be on mobile devices, not on desktops. So all of your design should really be mobile first at this point.
The last few weeks I've done interviews with companies like Poachable and Jobber in San Francisco and Switch in New York. And these are all stealth apps and it's all, you know, iOS driven or driven on Android devices where passive candidates now can kind of look for a job without looking for a job and not have to worry about their personal identity being exposed to their employers. And, you know, and I think that just goes to show the kinds of things that are getting developed on mobile now that couldn't even be imagined a couple of years ago.
No doubt about it.
And this is all big data stuff, by the way. Right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, yeah. You know, again, I mean, one of the reasons we wrote the book was because we saw, you know, 10% of companies doing this really well and using big data to be way more competitive in the marketplace than their peers. And the other 90% was sort of a split between those who, you know, knew they should be doing something but didn't know where to start and those who were kind of skeptical. And so we said, you know, let's take this 10% and just expose the examples, right? How are they being so successful with what they're doing? And, you know, by doing so, can we help the others be more successful as well? And there's a ton of opportunity right now to use big data to drive success. And these examples in the book are, I think, very telling to help people do that.
Can you give us an example or two of how you're using the advice that you wrote about in your book and the research that you've done with the work you're now doing at LinkedIn?
Absolutely. So one of the most sort of valuable things we're doing is building a multi-channel nurturing capability. So we had this with Bizo. We're now integrating this into LinkedIn. And the whole concept is looking at behaviors, looking at the demographics of the prospects that you care about, and using that to predict where in the funnel are they and what types of messages should we put in front of them based on where in the funnel they are and who they are. And the success is, it's we're still in the early phases, but we're seeing incredible lifts in response rates and return on investment.
Is there anything that we haven't discussed in this interview regarding your book that you think is important for our listeners or viewers to know?
I would just say, I think there's probably an example in there for everyone. When you look at the different ranges of things from Netflix to Amazon to Obama campaign to smaller companies like Zendesk that have created incredible success using big data, there's examples in there for everybody. Take a look, and I feel confident you'll learn something from it.
Well, thank you very much for taking time to speak with me today here on Total Picture Radio. It's great to have an opportunity to meet you over Skype video.
Yeah, always a pleasure. Thanks, Peter.
Russell Glass is the head of products for LinkedIn Marketing Solutions and co-author of The Big Data Driven Business, a book about how companies can use big data to drive results, published by Wiley. You'll find this interview in the Big Picture channel of Total Picture Radio. While there, please sign up for our newsletter, subscribe to our iTunes channel and our Total Picture Radio Facebook group, and I'm happy to connect with you on LinkedIn. Just please mention in your invite that you listen to the show. You can follow me on Twitter at Peter Clayton and at Total Picture, and connect with Russ on Twitter at Glass Russ. Thank you for tuning in to Total Picture Radio. This is Peter Clayton. Have a great day.